Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Chris Wilson, and I'm the Director of Experience Design here at the National Museum of American History, and I'd like to welcome you to our final day of the History Film Forum, this four-day exploration of history on the screen that the Smithsonian puts on with the National Endowment for the Humanities. A few kind of housekeeping things to get out of the way. We've had 4 days of just really wonderful programming. I know a lot of you have been here for multiple days. You've seen lots of people wearing these shirts, doing a lot of work around the museum, both from the Smithsonian and the NEH side. I just want to give a round of applause to all of my colleagues. It's been a lot of work to put this on, the folks up in the booth, our security staff, our purchasing staff here at the museum. If you go on our website, you can see a long, long list of everybody that made this happen. And so I'm really grateful for everyone's work, as well as the participation of so many wonderful panelists, including the ones that you're going to see on this next panel. Last year, or the first year of the History Film Forum in 2015 in November, we looked at issues of diversity in those programs, and we've done it even more this year. Our theme for the year in the National Museum of American History is a nation we've built together. That we build together, in fact, and that has been a theme of this program as well. We've looked at women in history filmmaking. We've looked at issues of race and representation, and this panel is going to continue looking at that. And we will, when Kelly Carter, our moderator, gets on stage, we'll talk through the just wonderful folks who have given their time to be part of it. And so I'm really grateful to all of them. We started all of our panels with film here at the History Film Forum. We're going to do the same thing today. If any of you were here on Thursday, you met our keynote interviewees, Sam Pollard and Doug Blackman. And Sam is back to take part in this panel, throughout the time of putting together the History Film Forum, we've been blown away by the willingness of filmmakers and scholars to share their work with us and with you at a really early stage. And Sam has provided some clips of an upcoming film that he and Doug Blackman are working on called The Harvest, looking at school desegregation issues in Leland, Mississippi. So you're going to see a couple of clips from The Harvest, and then our panel is going to take the stage, and Sam can tell you a little bit more about the film, and then we'll get into all of the issues. So thank you again, and we're going to roll our clips from The Harvest now and then get going. Thank you very much.
I said, I can't stay in this cotton field all of my life. I got to find something else to do. So I made up my mind. I said, I want to go to school. I want to go to college.
You can't hurry God.
Our school population need to reflect what our town population is. I thought all white people didn't like black people because my own father wouldn't acknowledge me.
I think the absence of, like, anything good, it just helped my drive to be better. The abundance of negativities, and, like, it supported my positivity.
He'll be there. Don't you worry.
I think the whole community should be involved. And my thing is, you know, color shouldn't have anything to do with it. We have to come together and work together.
I do envision going pro, yes sir, but I know it also requires hard work. That's my top goal.
you're gonna be challenged. So you have to take each moment of time, and you have to work at each thing so you can get up to where you need to be. He will make a way. How do you say?
But the dream did come true because even though they don't have to walk hand in hand each and every day, there are so many things we're doing in America together. We plan together, we live in the same neighborhoods now, we attend in this day and age same churches, and we go to the same schools, even if there happen to be areas where that's not going on, where that's not happening. You can always find a place where the dream is alive.
My mother told me
more people need to be involved in finding solutions for the school system, and I think it needs to be someone from both the black and the white community.
If you can see nothing but darkness, it's my reason to just look for the light, you know what I'm saying? In God's hands, he'll be there.
Don't you worry. It's vital that you bring up individuals together so that they will learn how to cope with different kind of, different races.
We all accept that that's what we need to do.
Yeah. Yeah.
He's a red on time.
It was a difficult life. It was really a difficult life where we chanked the hose in the wintertime, and we would take old Prince Albert tobacco cans and we would nail them to the floor in the wintertime to keep the air and the cold from coming in, and we'd take the cotton from the field and chank all around the windows and any other places that air would get in. And for the most part, we did not have indoor plumbing.
About 50 sharecropping families on the place, and sharecropping was a system that was in place then, and people don't understand nowadays how it was, but for most, it was a working relationship, and we had families, Daddy went after families that would stay here. He didn't want folks to come in one year and be gone, and so we had a lot of families that I was just more or less raised by, I guess.
My dad had gotten contented, and he had accepted this was the way of life. Don't go against it. This is how it is. This is the way it's going to be. We're just going to survive. But my mom always thought that there must be a better way.
We were raised up together with friends. We played baseball and football, blacks and the whites together, the youngsters. It was just, to me, it was a really good experience, and I think it was for a lot of the folks who were here on the place.
At that time, we had individuals who you would call straw bosses or plantation managers and so forth. Didn't own the plantation, but he was hired to do the supervising of the laborers. And my father must have done something that did not jail with the straw boss. And he kicked him once he got out of the truck and kicked my father.
One of my best memories, it was at Christmas time. And at Christmas time, the store would be closed on the Saturday before Christmas, or maybe it was Christmas Eve. And they would make, the Sibenagle was the company we bought our groceries from. The Sibenagle truck would back up to the store. Me and Daddy, Uncle Sam, Mr. McIntyre, his boys, Alton and Troy, we would all meet down there at the store and we would unload everything. Troy and I were the youngest, and we would spread out. There was a box of red net stockings, Christmas stockings, and we would spread those out on the one of the counters, and the men, and Alton was older, and they would unpack the boxes, and there would be navel oranges, there would be apples, all the citrus fruits, you know, nuts, the Brazil nuts, and almonds, and cashews, and there would be, that was back before they put them in cans, you know. There would be little toys for the younger children. There would be clothes probably for the older children. There would be something for the lady of the household. There would be something for the man of the household. And that would probably be picked out by Aunt Rose and Mama. Would put all the boxes, new label for each family, in the back of the trucks and deliver. This would be on Christmas Eve, so that every family had a Christmas. And it didn't make any difference if it was a bad crop year or a good crop year. Daddy always saw to it that there was something for Christmas every year for everybody on the place.
I remember many times Christmas, we would get some fruit and a few pieces of candy and then maybe a toy. And that was the way we lived. It was difficult. It was hard. It was challenging.
Hello, everyone. Are you all ready for our panel today, our discussion today? I think this is a really important and relevant topic, right? Are you ready for this? All right, good. My name is Xavier. I'm the host of Seriously Amazing Objects on the Smithsonian Channel and also My American Roots web series on the National Museum of American History's YouTube channel. Our panel, our moderator and panel are about to come up, but before they do, I want to make sure that everybody knows we are going to have a Q&A afterwards, which our moderator will handle. If you look to your left and to your right, you'll see microphones in the middle of the aisles, and those microphones are for people to go and ask their questions once they're prepared. Also, does anybody have a cell phone? Can you turn it off, please? Or at least silence it. You know, we want to be respectful of everyone, make sure everyone can hear what's going to happen. And at this time, I think Kelly, our moderator, is ready. She'll come on up.
Exactly. And no, my only goal was not to trip going up the stairs. So thank you guys for coming out this afternoon. Appreciate having you. And you guys are in for a treat because this is a fantastic panel. Hello. All righty. No, it does not matter to me. You know, this past year was monumental for Black filmmaking and storytelling. Among others, we saw Hidden Figures, The Free State of Jones, Fences, Loving, Moonlight. There were also powerful documentaries like I Am Not Your Negro, 13th, and the Oscar-winning ESPN film, O.J. Made in America. The African American Film Critics Association, of which I'm a member, called 2016 the best year ever for Black cinema. There were a record 6 Black actors who were nominated for Oscars, and 4 of the 5 Oscar-nominated documentaries were directed by Black filmmakers. Specifically, we saw Black history in ways that we'd never seen before on the silver screen, and refreshingly, we saw different narratives. And we all took notice. So the panel today is gonna explore that and maybe offer up some solutions to how we can get some more of that moment, you know, moving forward. So with that said, I want to introduce who we have on this illustrious panel. Today we have Faith Davis Ruffins, who is the curator of African American History and Culture and the Division of Home and Community Life at the Smithsonian's National Museum of American History, which we're in right now, based in Washington, D.C. Next to her, we have Sam Pollard, whose professional accomplishments as a feature film and television video editor and documentary producer, director, span more than 30 years. Pollard, we just saw a chunk of this film, which we're going to get into. And Spike Lee co-produced a couple of documentary productions for the small and big screen. Spike Lee presents Mike Tyson, a biographical sketch for HBO, for which Mr. Pollard received an Emmy, and Four Little Girls, which I'm pretty sure a lot of us saw, which was a feature-length documentary about the 1965 Birmingham church bombings, which was nominated for an Academy Award. We also have April Rain, who practiced law for nearly 20 years, honed her talent for public speaking and persuasive writing, but it wasn't until she walked away from her legal practice that she found her true passion. Now she's managing editor of Broadway Black, and Rain is able to capitalize on her strengths and pursue her calling, which is using her voice to spark dialogue and explore issues of race, politics, and culture. And you may have heard of a little something called Oscars So White. That's all because of this woman right here who really raised the consciousness for everyone paying attention to what was happening in Hollywood. So thank you for that. And next to April, we have Nicholas I. Wiggins, who most recently worked at the NAACP. And during your six-year tenure at the NAACP, he assisted in planning and executing the NAACP Image Awards and the organization's annual convention. So thank you for that. And last but certainly not least, we have Katie Borum Chatou, got it, who is the director of the Center for Media and Social Impact, which is an innovation lab and research center at American University that creates, showcases, and studies media designed for social change. And you're also the executive in residence at the American University School of Communication here in Washington, D.C. So everyone, thank you so much for joining the panel today. Before we really get going, I want to start with you, Sam. That was fantastic, what we just saw. What was that? Can you explain a little bit more? Because we want more.
Very briefly, Doug Blackman and I started this journey about 2.5 years ago where he wanted to go back to Leland, Mississippi, where he grew up, and look at what happened to that community when he was one of the first white kids to integrate the public schools down there in 1970. So the film is sort of his journey back into what happened from those early years when he was a little boy, when the desegregation of the schools really didn't work, and what's happened to his classmates, both black and white, in the years that have passed. And that's what the film's going to be about, looking at that generation and today's generation of young white and black children.
Fantastic. Any idea how soon we might be able to see that?
It'll probably be completed by spring of 2018.
Okay. Well, we will wait for that. Let's start here. And I would love to kind of go down the panel and kind of hear you guys weigh in on this. 2016 was a great year. There's still a lot of work to be done. But what do you all kind of individually attribute all of the kind of highlights that we celebrated in 2016 that happened in film to? Anyone can jump in and we just kind of go down.
Well, I think there are several factors. One is that the audience has enlarged. I think the fact that there are more millennials, maybe this isn't the best term, but there are a lot of younger people now in the population who have been brought up at a different time, and they constitute, you know, the biggest generation in American history, bigger than the baby boomers. I think that, there's a bigger audience that existed before. I think also, because some films in recent times have made a lot of money, but there was a history in which movies like Glory and Beloved and Amistad did not make a lot of money, but in recent times there have been some films that have really made a lot of money, and so that showed people in certain parts of, let's say, Hollywood or other areas that it was possible to make these films and that people would go to them. I think just currently we have seen with films like Hidden Figures, which was a film that wasn't made for a huge amount of money, but has made a lot of money, that this, the fact that, if there's no business, there's no show. So for people who are in show business, the fact that the business potential, I think, does make a big difference. I also think that the society is in a state of turmoil, and that there are people who are interested, not all of them young, some of them are more seasoned, who are being able to come to the fore with new perspectives, and that there are new outlets, not only on the web, but in all kinds of social media, there are new outlets. So it's a combination of a lot of different factors that I think created the possibilities, aside from, of course, the brilliance of the individuals who were involved in doing it. But I think that the audience, the possibility of actually making significant profit, and the ability to see things in a variety of different ways, experience them in a variety of different ways, which is also associated with that bigger, younger audience. All of those factors have something to do with what we're seeing today.
I'll add to that by saying that I think it's so exciting to have April on this panel to say this in front of, because later on I'll talk about nonfiction storytelling, but I think it's really important to acknowledge that the advocacy that happened around Oscar So White is hugely important in the mm-hmm. story. So we actually, as I just finished writing a report that I'm happy to send to you, there was, as a result of the critical consciousness around the idea that Oscar So White was a thing, it was a problem, it was systemic, all of that, it hadn't reached beyond Hollywood before then, right? So Hollywood has known this for a long time, and you're exactly right about the marketplace. So yes, proving that films can make money is important, but the consumer consciousness and the advocacy and the activism that came around that is a huge part of what happened. So for those of you who don't know, there was a record number of new Academy members that were invited in. This is a voting members right. of the Academy who vote on Oscar nominations, and in the case of documentary films, also shortlisted films. And so a record number, 683 new Academy voting members. And before they had invited them in, the Academy was 92% white and 75% male. Right. And so the people that were invited in were something like 40% people of color and also 40% women. Now that is enormous. And so, you know, again, we do a lot of work in nonfiction storytelling, which I'll talk about later, but we attribute so much of also what happened in the Academy Award nominations with nonfiction to that advocacy. And so I think it's important to say, especially in Washington, D.C., that advocacy really matters, and that mm-hmm. kind of consumer consciousness combined with the industry is really important, because otherwise it will just be a moment.
Right.
It won't be a trend. Thanks, April.
And I think audiences were clamoring for interesting stories with quality characters that expanded beyond just slave narratives and direct civil rights movement pieces. And so I think we see this in the crop of films that came out in 2016. And hopefully we'll continue to see that there are opportunities to tell so many stories within the communities of color.
I also want to think, I attribute all things good to President Obama. So, especially now, since he is former President Obama, but I think it's really important to talk about the last 8 years and the fact that we had a first family that was African American that sort of opened up a lot of people's minds and understanding to what it means, you know, to be a black family, you know, because they were just as normal as every other family, and yet they were up here on this pedestal because he was the leader of the free world. And I think that translates into the types of movies that we can see, because it's more accepting now. So, you know, if you look at even on the small screen, something like Empire and Blackish and Atlanta, you know, it's not just black people watching those shows. It is everybody watching those shows, because I think that part of what's happened in the last 8 years is that President Obama and the First Family has made it more palatable, unfortunately, for some, you know, to invite black people into their homes from the safety, you know, of being able to turn the channel if they, you know, if they feel uncomfortable, but also going out into a movie theater and watching something that they might not otherwise. You know, you look at 2015, for example, with Straight Outta Compton, Now, that's a movie. I mean, you want to talk about a niche, right? I mean, that is a movie with predominantly unknown actors about, you know, a gangsta, whatever that means, rap group from Compton, California. I mean, you can't get a smaller circle than that. and yet it grossed over $200 million worldwide. That wasn't just black folks going to see that film. Everybody went. And that's what Oscar So White is about. You know, if it's a good story, if it is performed well, everybody is going to watch it. And I think, you know, I think that President Obama and the First Family had a part in that as well.
Well, I would say this. I'm going to be the cynic here today. I've been around a pretty long time, and I've seen these moments where all of a sudden you see a lot of black cinema and black directors. I remember in the 90s on the cover of the New York Times, it was Matty Rich, Spike Lee, John Singleton, you know, Reggie Hudlin, and then it was Julie Dash and Nima Barnett. And all these other filmmakers who are coming out there making films, people are saying, wow, black film is finally having a presence. Yeah. Then there was that downturn. So it's great what's happened this year, but to me, Oscar is still so white, yeah. You know? So we'll see.
Yeah. I will, we've spoken about this before, is that, you know, there can be ups and downs. And, but in order to make something as I think April and Katie said, in order to make something a trend rather than just a moment, mm-hmm. Advocacy and activism are really very important. Mm-hmm. But I would agree that no one should be satisfied,
right.
Because without advocacy and activism, it certainly will be a moment, and there have been previous moments,
sure.
that did not continuously lead to this one.
And we must remember too that in Hollywood, much of the people who greenlight these films are not black people or people of color.
Yes,
you know, they may be happy now, but I've seen the worm turn.
Well, I'm not going anywhere.
I was going to say, first off, cynicism is absolutely welcome here at this panel. But I was going to actually ask you. You brought up two different things, so I'm gonna have two different questions. But the first one is, what has to happen so that we can sustain what we saw in 2016? In your estimation as a filmmaker, in both of y'all's estimation as people who pay attention to social activism, and so on, like what has to happen so that 25 years from now we're not saying, damn, you know, 2016 was a really great year and then it all went away?
The advocacy has to continue. I mean, it's the kind of advocacy that you mentioned. I mean, I'm a member of the Academy, I'm a member of the documentary branch, and you're absolutely right. You know, when we went to vote for new members, we were looking for more diversity, more inclusiveness in our branch. Mm-hmm. And hopefully in all the other branches, they're doing the same thing. Mm-hmm. That kind of advocacy has to continue. And the second thing that has to continue is those people who greenlit Hidden Figures, which is a phenomenal film, those people who greenlit, you know, Moonlight, they have to continue to greenlight those kind of stories from filmmakers like Barry Jenkins, you know, from filmmakers like Lee Daniels, from filmmakers like Cassie Lemons. They got to keep bankrolling those kind of films when these filmmakers bring those stories to them, you know, and that's how it's gonna continue.
And so for our audience, it's important for you all to get out there and use the platform that you have. Now, there's nothing special about me. I am not part of the film industry. I put three little words together and put a symbol in front of it, and here we are. But there's nothing that says that you can't do the same thing. So what does that mean? Number one, don't reward mediocrity. What we're going to see in the next couple of years is everybody's going to be attempting to make a film about some marginalized community. Is that important? Yes. Are they going to be good? No. Some of them will, but some of them won't. And so don't go see them just because it's got a Latino face or an Asian American face. But when the films are good, it's important for you to register your pleasure with your hard-earned movie dollars. And then talk it up on social media just as I have. Tell a friend, take a family member. Go be an advocate for what you believe in, because it really is all about the bottom line. If you look at something like Hidden Figures, which is now the highest grossing film of all time to be nominated for Best Picture at $150 million and counting, but it centers three black women. That's never happened before, and it's incredibly exciting. But what it says to Hollywood is stories about black people make money, and people other than Denzel and Will Smith can open a film. And it's unfortunate we're still talking about that in 2016 and now 17, but that's what matters. You know, the bottom line is what matters in any organization, corporation, what have you. And so we need to make sure that we are continuing the activism and speaking out on issues. Tell Hollywood what it is that you want to see. When it comes out, go support it. Go to forums like this. Go to the smaller film festivals, because that's where a lot of the magic happens that you don't get to see on the 24-screen multiplex down the street.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for that. Let's do a little film history 101, because April, Nicholas, Faith, you guys all kind of mentioned one thing that I definitely wanted to get into, which is we saw a different narrative of black filmmaking, you know, happening in 2016. And I think probably the chief argument that a lot of black audiences had, is that we were seeing the same types of stories that were being told of, you know, the uglier side of American history, and very stark side of American history. But Hidden Figures was definitely not that. I mean, certainly we kind of got into an era that was very challenging, obviously, to say the least, for African Americans, but we saw a story that a lot of us had never studied at our fourth grade history books. That said, who decides in Hollywood what truths are to be told? You know, who is the person who is greenlighting and saying, these are the stories, these are the black stories that we think audiences will flock to and will have something of substance for a movie-going audience to see?
I mean, Sam said it. It's white folks. I mean, we're gonna break it down, right?
It's white people who run the studio.
Right, and no, it's
white
older.
People in general.
Well, clearly not. But I mean, you know, it's older white men who are the studio heads, and that's why it's so important that we have somebody like Ava DuVernay,
right,
who said, "I'm not going to wait for a seat at your table.
Right.
I'm going to build my own mansion, yes, and put my own damn table in that mansion." Right? It's why we have Tyler Perry, who has a specific niche, you know, but he made his own studio in Atlanta so that he wouldn't have to worry about whether he could get greenlit. You know, but there's a reason why it doesn't make sense to me that someone, a consummate filmmaker like Spike Lee, has to crowdsource a film.
Right.
That doesn't make sense to me. And so there needs to be a discussion. I mean, you know, Oscar So White is not just about the actors and actresses that you see. It's also about the editors and the filmmakers behind the camera, because it's their frames of reference that we really need to hear from. You know, so if you think of something like Godfather 1 and 2, right? Fantastic films. Francis Ford Coppola, they're like in my top five of all time. But they were in his frame of reference. And then if you take those films directed by Francis Ford Coppola and you substitute Michael Bay, also a white man, but completely different films. And that's why frames of reference are important behind the screen. Who's editing? You know, if the director does 40 takes, it's the editor that decides this is the one that's going into the film. And so it's his or her frame of reference that is important. That's why it's so important. We're talking about in 2016, we had the first black female editor ever nominated for an Oscar.
Yeah. Just to add to what you said, I think several things that you said are really important. One is there are people who have, Tyler Perry being the consummate example, who started with plays and musicals and built an audience, which then led to his ability to make films. So what, build a studio and make his own films. So one, I think that the possibilities of alternatives exist in ways that probably weren't true in the 40s, 50s, and somewhat earlier. Two, I would say that it's important to understand the ground that documentary films, since we are talking about documentary films, at least on some level, can really play. And they are supported by an alternative set of support, which includes things like the National Endowment for the Humanities and the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and other sources, which are potentially under attack at present. So how you can find out about, there are a million stories,
as they used to say, in the Naked City. But it takes an artist to look at a particular story and to make it into something that people want to see. So I think there are multiple avenues. There are more avenues than existed before. But it's still true that the most, the shiniest, most, that you get the most fame from comes from the Hollywood movie industry. But there are alternative ways that films get made, and there are alternative outlets, not just television, but of course on the web and other ways that people see things now. And that creates a lot of opportunities that maybe a filmmaker like Oscar Michaud in the 20s simply didn't have.
Spencer Williams.
And I think it's important, again, that we have to be cautious. 2013, we were saying, oh, this is the Black Renaissance of film, when The Butler and 42. And so, you know, UCLA just came out with their diversity report. We're still at, 10% among directors, 5% among screenwriters. So we have a lot of work to do. And so it's advocacy, activism, and audience engagement.
Can I address the doc stuff? You can see I'm about to burst out of my chair. So I'll get on a soapbox just for a second. So I study documentaries and I make documentaries because I believe in how important they are, not only as an art form, but as a really vital place in democracy. Mm-hmm. We actually have a growing amount of data that shows that people actually look to documentaries not only as entertainment, but because they're filling a hole and a lens and a frame of stories that are not being told, entire angles that are not being told, people we are not hearing from. I've always seen documentaries that way. And one of the things that we wanted to investigate over the past year, because, you know, so I go to film festivals and I am in the space and all of that. And I would see every year at the festival circuit, there would be glorious stories, and they were deserved, of women like Dawn Porter, amazing, exceptional filmmakers who were winning all the awards. But the trade stories would say things like, we've solved our diversity problem in documentary. I thought, there's no way that's true. So we decided to investigate it, and we actually went back in 10 years of data. We just released a report called Oscars So White for Documentaries Too, and Male. And what we found was actually pretty shocking, and I'll go into why I think this matters so much. We actually found that over 10 years of data looking at 1,200 credited creative people, producers and directors, we coded for all of them, 190 directors, over 1,000 producers, we found that more than 9 in 10 of them are white. And women are slightly more represented, but not really, right? And directors and producers of color are the most underrepresented. So obviously, this is a problem that goes way before we even get to the moment where we can invite people into the academy, right? Mm-hmm. It's film school. Mm-hmm. It is what's happening in other school. I remember in my film school class at USC, without even anybody feeling bad about this 15 years ago, there were 2 women of color in my cohort of 30 people. There were, by the way, 5 women, so that was also a problem. But that, it's all the way down at that level. And the one other piece that I would say about that is that this is incredibly important to pay attention to, particularly for documentary film. And it just so happens that my expertise is in documentary, so I couldn't speak with any kind of credibility about scripted films. But this is really important to examine. Who is allowed to tell the stories? Who is allowed to tell whose stories? Who is even allowed to get into the funding arena? Who even knows about the NEH grants? All of that matters. And so we have a whole series of studies that's examining this because we think it's a whole system-wide situation, and there needs to be media literacy on behalf of all of us at every level of that, not just from the consumer level, but behind the scenes.
You know, I would venture to say that if we're talking about the Oscars, that the documentary category was probably the most exciting race until we got to Best Picture. But you know, but it was, to me, it was the most exciting race because A, I thought that it was a ridiculously phenomenal category of fantastic directors, and you know, we had 4 out of the 5 directors nominated were Black, and 4 of those documentary or 3 of those documentaries were about blackness or race and gender issues, so on and so forth. But according to that report, it sounds like that may have just been a little bit of a flash in the pan. That's not necessarily where we are right now.
Well, this is what I started by saying, that when we look at a moment, we should celebrate the moment. I want to be really clear about that. So the lead of our study says 2017 was a real moment for documentary filmmakers of color. we should celebrate that, but we should not sit back, because that is a moment. It was a moment that responded to advocacy, and it was authentic, and all of that. And those films are incredible, and they deserve. I mean, I don't know how the Academy decided between those five films, same, by the way. Yeah, Sam, I don't know how you decided. but yes, when you look at the trend data, even 2 years ago, we looked at, there were zero filmmakers of color represented in that category 2 years ago. Zero. And last year was 18%. So this is not, in over 10 years, by the way, statistically, there's no change, right, over 10 years, from 2008 to 2017. We need to, that is something to pay attention to, right? It's not just a moment, but it's, and by the way, the gender stuff is also
But it goes to what April's saying, it's the same kind of advocacy that needs to happen in documentaries. I mean, one of the reasons when they asked me to come down here to talk this week, you know, the reason I wanted to come is not only because, you know, I'm a major proponent of the NEH, but I knew about the emerging filmmakers when Chris asked me to do the panel with the emerging filmmakers. It's good to see, you know, a lot of young people of color in that room yesterday, and me as a person of color being able to talk to them and talk to them about my experience and what it means to make documentary film. When I started in the business many, many years ago as an apprentice editor, you know, for 4 or 5 years, I was the only black face in the room. You know, then I learned there were other people around like St. Clair Bourne and Charles Hobson, you know. Then as I started to develop a career, other people of color came up, Marco Williams, Stanley Nelson, you know, Louis Messiah, you know, so there's more of us, you know, Dawn Porter. But it takes advocacy. It takes, you know, as a filmmaker, when I'm looking for young people, I'm looking for people of color, you know, everybody. I'm looking for people with talent, but I'm also going to focus on people of color. If someone out there, like some of these young filmmakers, come up to me and say they have projects and they need help, that's part of the responsibility to get more of them in the business, to help them. You know, that's what it takes. You know, and it is phenomenal about what happened with the best documentary films. But it wasn't that was pretty easy who was gonna win that one, though.
Really? I don't know how you're I just wanted to add one other thing on top of what Sam said. I think the mentorship piece is really hugely important, and I think that sometimes when we talk about voting with our wallets and all of that, yes, all of that is important, but I think even down at the level, I mean, I'm also a college professor, so I see how important mentorship is huge, but specifically, Stanley Nelson, you know, Firelight Media, an incredible award-winning, you know, MacArthur genius organization run by Stanley Nelson and Marcia Smith, they have mentorships for young filmmakers of color, and they're putting producers in all kinds of projects. Now, that is really meaningful, and that is really an inclusive strategy. And they're also, you know, when we think about gender inclusion, you know, I look at both because I look at both. And Sundance has done similar work in terms of recognizing the issue and then developing programs to actually deal with it. Because the data, who cares if you have data if it doesn't become strategy, right? Or advocacy, who cares? It's just navel gazing.
And thank you for that ESPN shout out, because I too thought that should have won best documentary, even though I love Ava. April, you know, let's talk a little bit about Oscar So White. That viral campaign was important and powerful, and I don't even know if, when, as you said, when you put three little words together with a symbol sign, if you were even acutely aware of the action and the reaction. I remember talking with Cheryl, who is a president of the Academy, probably 2 years ago after the campaign launched, and when she said, at that point, when she extended her the invitation to the first crop of people, I asked her, was this a direct result of that campaign? And it was absolutely yes, and then we have seen it grow in leaps and bounds and kind of saw what happened this year. Can you talk a little bit about what you take away from that, and were you surprised by the action and reaction of something that you started on Twitter? And I watched it as you started on Twitter as the announcements came in for the Oscars that year.
So I would love to have this really sexy story about, you know, I was sitting in my boardroom with my people and we decided that this is going to be, you know, and use all those words, we ideated over, you know, and decided that this was going to be our campaign for the next 18 months. No. I was half naked in my family room. True story.
That's sexy.
True story. No, I'll tell you why I was half naked in my family room, not my bedroom. The Oscars were my Super Bowl. Although I love football, the Oscars were my Super Bowl. And I mean, I would pregame. There were snacks involved. You know, I watched the whole thing with the gowns and the, all of the run-up. I would make sure that I had seen every film in the four acting categories and Best Picture every year. I mean, I was dedicated. I was down. And then, so I was, January 2015, Chris Hemsworth, who plays Thor in the Marvel action series, was the one announcing the nominations. I needed him in HD on our big screen TV. So that's why I was getting dressed for work in front of the family room TV, because that's where our big one is, and watching. And just, it just happened very organically. You know, every single category, you know, there weren't any people of color, there weren't any women, there weren't any out LGBTQIA people, over and over and over. And so I just, my phone, of course, is never far, so I just picked up my phone and I said, "Oscar so white, they asked to touch my hair." and that was it. That it was a one-off. You know, and then I went back upstairs and finished getting dressed, and you know, and I got my cell phone at work at lunchtime, and the hashtag was trending internationally. It had already gone viral, but it was snark. It was, you know, people, Oscar so white, they eat mayonnaise sandwiches. You know, Oscar so white, they wear Birkenstocks in the wintertime. I mean, you know, it was, there was nothing deep about the hashtag initially. It wasn't until a couple of days later that the conversation turned, and we started talking about issues of diversity and inclusion and what I really meant about the hashtag. And then I had to say, okay, this is something. Are you going to be the face? You know, are you going? Is this your thing? And it became my thing. And then I had to get up to speed and study and realize, you know, in at that time over 80 years of Academy history, we had four women directors nominated for Best Director, and only one has ever won. You know, and then if you look at the numbers for Black folks, if you look at the numbers for the LGBTQIA community, the Asian community, the Latina, the Latinx community, the numbers are stark and they're unfortunate. Mm-hmm. And so it became, you know, my job to sort of work on the outside and say, hey, you know, I'm a moviegoer, you guys have to do better. And it, everything starts on the page for me, you know. So it's about the sexy categories, you know, best actor and actress and supporting and best director. But let's talk about editor and cinematographer and documentary and all those other ones that don't get enough play. Because for me, if you talk about, if it starts on the page and you've got a young screenwriter who says their protagonist is going to be a tall, leggy blonde between the ages of 25 and 35, by the time that goes through them and the producer and the director and everybody else and finally gets greenlit, nobody's thinking Gina Rodriguez, right? Meryl Streep can't even audition for that role because she's outside of the age range. And so that's why it's so important that we are honoring and mentoring young folks from the very beginning and ensuring that they are having their stories told so that when we get to that level, I mean, you know, the Oscars are just the end of the line. Mm-hmm. You know, it is just a physical manifestation of job well done. Mm-hmm. But we need to talk about what's going on in Hollywood from the very beginning and making the push there so that we do have more things that can be nominated and voted on.
Thank you. That was a phenomenal answer. And along those lines, though, I certainly understand why we focus so much on the Oscars, because they are the Super Bowl of this industry. But should we really, and how much weight should we be giving an award show like the Oscars when it comes to recognizing the work of Black films and Black documentaries, and so on and so forth? Should we be focusing on like a group like NAACP and what they do with the Image Awards, which is, you know, and why it was kind of created, was to recognize kind of the diverse images of Black stories or people of color. Are we giving the Oscars too much power?
I get this question a lot. You know, and why do we need to be validated by this majority institution? And, you know, and we have our own stuff. And I get that. And it's unfortunate that NAACP and the ALMA Awards and the GLAAD Awards had to be created to recognize people that were not getting recognition otherwise. But as it stands right now, and we can argue whether it should be this way or not, the Oscars are still seen as the pinnacle, right? And I don't care if you are a fast food service worker or the CEO of a corporation or, you know, an actress who commands $15 million per film. Everyone wants to receive recognition for a job well done. And that's what the Oscars are. That's in my mind how I see it. And so, yes, we can do both. They don't have to be mutually exclusive. Are we giving them too much power? Maybe. I mean, you know, Sam can talk better than anybody about what it means on the inside. But now that we're seeing a change, and even though we've had 683 new members, the Academy is still 89% white and 73% male, and the average age is in its early 60s. So there's still a lot more to be done. But whether they should get the lofty aspirations that we give them is a question to be decided.
Well, I think the Oscars still remain the end of the season. The Image Awards, which is approaching 50, you know, in a couple of years, has been that show where we honor, you know, multicultural performances of color that should be recognized. And so just coming out of that most recently, I think it's still important. We moved the Image Awards into the heart of award season for a reason. Because it is not just a celebration, it is an advocacy tool to say, you know, when our nominations come out, you know, before the Oscar nominations come out, we are saying this is what we feel are quality performances within communities of color that we need to celebrate. And so I think the Image Awards and the Oscars should coexist, and that the Image Awards is still an important tool for advocacy and celebration.
Yeah, can I just add one thing that I think is really important, particularly for people that don't work in the entertainment business? Actually, most of my career, I was just telling you before, I was in Hollywood. So that formal Hollywood system is part of my own background. It's really important for people to understand that Hollywood is actually a collection of freelancers, right? They are people who go from film to next film to TV pilot season to hiatus. And so the Oscars is not just the Oscars. As a business model, that is your calling card, right? And so your ability to have a career that is sustained in creativity, if you happen to get in that level of the Academy Awards, that is actually really important from a career perspective. So I think that's something that people who work in film understand that, but that's a sort of media literacy piece that I think is important. It goes back to why it's important for us to pay attention to the Oscars, not because it's a navel-gazing moment for people to dress up and look fancy, but because it goes to who's allowed to be an artist at all, mm-hmm. who's allowed to get the next job, who's allowed to get their script read, who's allowed to get an agent. All of that, you back into all of that from the award circuit.
You know, I think I should come at it from two perspectives. I mean, I grew up as a kid loving to watch the Oscars with Bob Hope and Jimmy Stewart and Grace Kelly and all that silly stuff, you know, because I love movies. You know, and being in the business a long time and being nominated for an Oscar, you know, I'll say when I went to the Oscars in 97, I was like a kid. I thought, oh, shit, there's Sean Connery. Oh, man, there's Warren Beatty. But I also know, too, that it's a show, you know, and it's a fun show. And there's a part of me that says, Sam, don't take this too seriously. Mm-hmm. I was upset when we lost on Four Little Girls, but it's also a show. You know, I'm like you. I watch it from the carpet shit all the way to the... But to me, you know, it's about understanding that it's just a show, and you should just say, okay, this system of Hollywood, this system of making movies, hasn't done its job in terms of people of color in the industry. And the advocacy is the important part, and who's greenlighting these films, who's writing these scripts, who's casting these films, that's got to be thought more and more. And they're thinking about it more and more. So that's what makes me feel good about it, you know. I mean, when we won the NAACP award, I was as proud of that as when I was nominated for the Oscar. So to me, you gotta look at it with a grain of salt, you know. Yeah. And the other thing too, and I'm gonna challenge this too. Some of these people win Oscars, particularly the documentary people. It doesn't do a hell of a lot for your career.
Yeah, especially for women, by the way. That's actually in our study. For women, they're not more likely to get anything.
Yeah, sometimes you don't do anything. It doesn't get you any kind of big jobs, maybe 1 out of 10, you know. So you got to be mindful of that, too.
Now, you know, April is one woman, one powerful woman with a hell of a hashtag game.
But she's one woman. So my question is, as we're talking about advocacy in Hollywood, you know, what should the role be of organizations like the NAACP or the African American Film Critics Association? Like, who should be picking up that flag and kind of carrying it alongside people like April?
I think all of us up here on this panel.
Please.
But she, what she did though, what April did was a seismic shift. I mean, listen, when we went, I'm on the documentary membership committee. When we had our meeting last year, and we were saying, Jesus, man, this Oscar So White is kicking our ass, you know? And we got our list of new names, every one of us, those of us who were black, those who were white, those who were women, we were looking at that list with a fine-tooth comb. Oh, this person, she's been around for, oh, Holly Jarima, how come he's not in the Academy? Oh, Carmen Billups, how come she's not in the Academy? Oh, you know, she started a seismic shift.
Yeah.
She just scared everybody.
I do think it's to sort of shift a little. I think it is interesting to ask questions about, since you know we're at a documentary and we're in a museum where we do history, and to talk about what are the differences in experiencing history in the context of a film, a feature film, which is what Hidden Figures is, or a documentary film, such as the work Sam has done. I don't know how many of you were here to see Slavery by Another Name, which was earlier in this series, but I think there's some really interesting questions about audience and about the perception and understanding of history that might be interesting to talk about too.
Okay. Well, let's get into it. I mean, you know, the success of Hidden Figures, which is a feature film, obviously, but it's a film about history, a history that we hadn't explored yet. With the success of that film, it didn't win an Oscar, but it went in, as you mentioned, the most successful film being nominated for an Oscar this year. Are we assuming that studio executives are thinking, what else can we find? What else can we get out there? What else can we green light? Because we might be onto something, lo and behold, and there may be an audience out there that wants to consume more of this type of storytelling.
Well, I'm not sure I know what people are doing in Hollywood. Sam can tell you more about that. But I would say, I would offer a thoughtful caution. There was an earlier moment in the late 60s, early 70s, in which a couple of movies came out, probably one of the more interesting ones, that's very complex, is the movie Shaft, which was directed by Gordon Parks, you know, who was a famous photographer and who had directed some previous films. And after that came out, then this whole era of blaxploitation films emerged, which even though the blaxploitation films are, they have an audience among younger people and they're quoted and referred to by a lot of younger people, at the time, many people criticized these blaxploitation films because they were completely unrealistic and they stereotyped urban black communities. So one of the things that I would wonder about or encourage people to reinforce in all these ways, such as April and all these forms of advocacy, is to look to real stories that are authentically part of communities of color and try and get those kinds of stories to the fore. Because there is certainly a danger that people look at this success, or at least it's happened before, that people look at this success and then start randomly picking all kinds of things that don't have the kind of authenticity. For example, Hidden Figures came from a book. How many of you who saw Hidden Figures have read the book? Okay, I've read the book. And it's interesting to see the differences between the book and the film. Right. Now, I think it's an incredibly powerful film that has these three wonderful actresses at the center of it. But it's not exactly the same as the history that's in the book.
Sure.
Okay? And that's an interesting thing to talk about. It's like, you know, what do we know? What can we understand in something like a feature film? Mm-hmm. What does it tell us about historical experience that is different from what you can learn in other media, such as a well-researched book written about that historical experience.
Right. Now, is that a compromise that we have to, because I feel like one scene in Hidden Figures that was problematic for me at least was the bathroom scene. And I was like, pretty sure that probably didn't actually happen.
That's not in the book.
Yeah, of course. Of course.
Just in case you wanted to know. That's not in the book.
Never happened. That's part of the Hollywoodization of telling historical stories. Is that distracting to you as someone who focuses on history?
Well, I would just say, I can see that people need to make things dramatic.
Sure.
And the notion, the high concept of it takes energy to break down barriers. Mm-hmm. At that level, that moment in the film energizes you with this feeling of, you know, it takes energy and activity and purpose to break down barriers. But on the level of, is it literally true? Right. No, it's not literally true. So I'd be interested in hearing what some of the filmmakers think about those kinds of issues.
Well, you know, anytime you take a real person, a real story, and you're going to make it into a fiction film, there's always going to be what we call dramatic license.
Yes.
You know, I knew that. I haven't read the book, but I knew Kevin Costner in that book. That guy never did that. You know, because
you had a suspicion. Huh?
It wasn't a suspicion. I knew it.
But that's
always a challenge when you transfer something from, you know, real history to filmmaking. You know, the director, the producers, they take dramatic license. They compromise. They conflate characters who maybe, right, there may be more than one character in the real story. You know, but that's part of this Hollywood game. I mean, that's what you have to be aware of. I mean, as a documentary filmmaker, even as a documentary filmmaker, I do some things that, you know, when I did Slavery by Another Name, right, that was a 500-page book.
Right.
I didn't make a 500-page film. I made a 90-minute film, and I took out sections from the book because there was no way I could do it that way. So you always have to understand that. But the thing you have to understand, too, is that when you're making these films about a black subject and they have a representation of a character like Kevin Costner's character, the question is, why did they do that? Mm-hmm. What was the motivation behind that? You know, because it gave Costner, it gave, go ahead, Dave.
No, I definitely don't want to interrupt you. But your cynicism is rubbing off. So, you know, so that was the white savior moment in the film. I mean, you know, let's be real about what that was. You know, I mean, he's got this heavy weapon and he is breaking down the walls. You know, you can sort of hear the Negro spiritual in the background, right?
Okay. Black people can pee where white people can pee at NASA.
Exactly. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. Amen. You remember, the power.
You remember when Matthew Broderick died in the glory? When he died, that's when Denzel said, "No, let's go."
That was the thing. But
of course, the character that he played did die in the battle at Fort Wagner. But yes.
But that's something that we really need to talk about. I mean, you know, you talk about the color purple, mm-hmm, and the fact that there was clearly some, you know, bisexual or LGBT, sure, stuff happening, mm-hmm, you know, between Seeley and Suge, and we didn't see that in the movie. And, you know, and so that is the unfortunate compromise that we have to make. You know, even more recently, Don Cheadle said very clearly he would not have been able to make Miles Ahead, mm-hmm, which, you know, this biopic or biopic, depending on how you pronounce it, about Miles Davis, who should have a gazillion documentaries, mm-hmm, and feature films about him, unless he introduced this white character. And that's where we are. I mean, that's just unfortunate reality, and that's why I keep pushing, and everyone should keep pushing to say no. His story is valid on its own,
right,
and he doesn't need any help to tell his story because he didn't need any help living his life.
Right. I would love for those of you who have questions to get them ready, because I'm going to call on you in a minute. But before I kick it to the audience, you know, there were a lot of films, as we've acknowledged, that have really told black stories in 2016. And 2017, there's more coming, and there are more that are getting greenlit. You know, the Tupac biopic is coming, The Immortal Life of Henrietta Lacks is coming to HBO. There's a Thurgood Marshall biopic that's finally coming this year. But here's my question for all of you guys. What historical
black story would you love to see done, documentary or feature film? Like, what else should people be paying attention to? Like, I, for one, I thought I was pretty studied about history, and I had no idea about these women at Hidden Figures, which a lot of us had no idea about these women. But there are some obvious stories, I think, that Hollywood has been missing and not telling. I know Viola Davis has been trying to get Barbara Jordan, you know, biopic off the ground for years. What else would you guys love to see Hollywood pay attention to so that we're talking about those stories in the coming years?
I want to say the Flint water crisis.
Okay.
And maybe a documentary as opposed to a feature film.
Yes.
However it gets made. And there's talk now about a thing, and I think Cher is attached, and I have questions and concerns. Just because, you know, I don't want it to be Cher-centered, you know, and she comes in as this teacher, and she's got this little brown child who, you know, it has a rash, and, you know, and then she becomes the savior, whatever. Mm-hmm. You know, I would love to see it done as a documentary with real folks right there on the ground right now.
It's a great idea.
It is being done by as a documentary by a young woman I met at the IDA Getting Real in October. She's doing a documentary.
Fantastic.
I saw it.
Do you know a documentary opened that case? Yes, I have I'm writing about it right now. A documentary.
So now I would like $1 million since I'm just speaking things into existence.
Any other stories that you guys are thinking about that would be kind of cool to see get that silver screen treatment? I'm gonna let you guys think about that.
There's so many, right?
Yeah,
a lot of I mean, I think there should be a Trail of Tears. Film, you know, so that's obviously not a black thing, but you know, but Oscar so white is supposed to be inclusive. It is inclusive, and so we almost never see stories about First Nation folks, you know, and they are marginalized, you know, in ways that, you know, black stories aren't. And so I think there needs to be more of that as well.
Fantastic. All right, we're gonna kick it to the floor. Any questions? Right here.
Hey, oh, by the way, guys, if you do have any questions, you can make your way to the mics to the right and the left. I have a question.
Okay.
And it's a question on narrative features. So back in the 90s, there were a lot was made over colorblind casting or like color bent casting, if that makes sense. And we've seen over the past couple of years a similar thing start to happen. Here with like the new Spider-Man film that's coming out, there's I think a colorblind cast and that, some other stuff. And then of course with Hamilton, you know, that kind of has changed the game for that. And so my question for the panel is, what do you think the role of these sorts of things like colorblind or color bent casting is in opportunities for actors and for characters on screen? And also what are some of the, you know, the Pandora's box that opens, what are some of the challenges behind that approach? Mm-hmm.
So I talk about this a lot because I'm also the managing editor of Broadway Black, which is a multimedia platform that highlights the successes and achievements of African Americans on and off the Broadway stage. And with a juggernaut like Hamilton, you know, it goes back to me saying it's about the story. Right? And so everybody, if you look at Hamilton, the audience is incredibly diverse, like this one, and the people on stage are incredibly diverse. And people are taking out second mortgages to go see this play, this musical, you know, because it's a good story. So I think, you know, I say all the time, you know, why is it 2017, we've never had a rom-com featuring two LGBTQIA people. You know, why is it that, you know, we have the amazing Sir Patrick Stewart playing a disabled superhero in the X-Men franchise, but we don't have a disabled man or woman playing a superhero or even just a regular person?
Yeah.
So, you know, I think it's really important that studio heads and green lighters and casting agents are open-minded and get rid of their implicit bias, you know, when talking about these things, about who can play what role. And I think we see it happens a lot easier on the smaller screen on TV than it does, you know, look at Shonda Rhimes. Like, Shonda Rhimes has taken Grey's Anatomy and said, you know what, we are going to have doctors of every age, of every gender, of every sexual orientation, of every race, and that's what doctors look like because that's what the community looks like. There's no reason why we can't do that in film. Mm-hmm.
Very true. Mm-hmm. Thank you for that question.
Yeah, thank you, panelists. I was just wondering, what aspect or how would you recommend to come out from a grassroots perspective using advocacy now that we know being validated is a challenge, especially within the community. So what would you recommend to use digital storytelling, or what other tools would you recommend based on your expertise for us to get the stories within the community and maybe hopefully get it to Hollywood? Would you recommend to get it from a grassroots advocacy perspective, or just keep on striving to get to Hollywood?
I think there's so many avenues now in terms of getting your product out there. You don't have to strive just to go for Hollywood. There's social media, there's the internet, you know, there's YouTube. There's so many avenues now. I mean, you know, everybody's doing web series now. You know, there's many ways to do it. You don't have to think about trying to make it to Hollywood. That shouldn't be the ultimate goal. The ultimate goal is to create something that you feel very personal about and strongly about, that you want to make a good film or a good television show or a good episode. That's what you want to do. You know, don't think about making it to Hollywood, because that's very small, the number of people who are going to get there anyway. Just create good work.
Absolutely. Yeah. That was actually what I was getting at. Thank you.
Yeah, I have a friend who, a very talented filmmaker, whose name is Matthew Cherry, and he created a film called Nine Rides completely on an iPhone. Mm-hmm. And it was showcased at South by Southwest last year. So, I mean, as you were saying earlier, there's so many different avenues now. There's Netflix. I mean, Netflix is an Academy Award, you know, a nominated organization now, as is Amazon. So it doesn't have to go to Academy, to Hollywood necessarily to make it big, because we've got all of these digital and online avenues and resources. Just make good work and people will see it.
You know, one other thing, just to address Hollywood for a second, although I totally agree that Hollywood should not be your only destination. But there's such a big shift in Hollywood talent finding, actually. The major agencies now have entire divisions that are devoted to scouring for interesting storytellers on YouTube and other places. So they are finding people. And again, that doesn't mean that you have to just go into the Hollywood development deal on that scene of your story. But generating those stories and making them is now a recognized part of their own business model to actually find you on YouTube. So that BBC guy is going to be discovered any minute.
And I was going to say, you're totally right. Lee Daniels told me that Instagram is like his favorite place to discover creatives in front of and behind the camera, too. So it's happening a lot more often than you think. Thank you for that question. Over here.
He just literally stole like half my question. So, but as a filmmaker that came in for the thing from Hollywood, I'd just like to say thanks again for this. And give a shout out to my film school, UCLA, which for the last 10 years has admitted 50% women and ethnically diverse. Of course, not California, because California is 15% white. But anyway, I was actually literally going to ask about those emerging and storytellers, and if there were any specific things out there for that the NAACP is doing or anything like that for specifically black filmmakers to get out. Like you said, the Instagram and the Snapchat, and I can tell you that's where a lot of the stuff is happening. So I'm just curious, like, what's happening, like, on that, you know, grassroots level to really push that up.
Well, so the NAACP has a Hollywood bureau out in California that dedicates itself 24/7 to this and increasing opportunities for projects to be seen. And so we do that through a various amount of ways. And then on the Image Awards side, we're continually expanding our category. So I hope in the next year or two you see a YouTube Series of the Year category. Et cetera, so that we can, again, raise the bar and challenge the other award shows to do the same.
Thank you. Let's kick it over here.
Good afternoon. As a documentary producer who started before the digital platform, some of the challenges that I and my other colleagues faced was green lighting in terms of seed funding for emerging documentarians. And being able to get out and being able to do large locations, scouting and scenes and things like that. So I thought maybe the panel, or if there's anyone here, particularly from NEH, to talk about what's going on in terms of green lighting stories, these underrepresented stories, and also first time, or maybe even those with a smaller portfolio of documentary films. So we make sure that those continue to go out, not only just for the public to see, but also preservation.
I'm mean, I'm happy to start that one. I mean, I'm certainly not an expert on this, but I do spend most of my film ecosystem time with the documentary community, IDA, and others. There are actually now a lot more opportunities for emerging documentary filmmakers, almost more than mid-career ones, actually, in terms of, but I mean, look, let me just go ahead and acknowledge my beloved documentary space has a, it's a finite pool of money, actually. It's like the same 8 funders, there's some personal investors, but people are competing for the same pot of money. It can get pretty tricky. But there are a number of funds now, and actually on the International Documentary Association, you know what I'm saying, IDA, website, there are a number of opportunities. There are groups like Chicken and Egg that give funding for first-time female filmmakers. So there is a concerted effort in that community to pay attention to emerging filmmakers. Now, there is still a really big chicken and egg problem, no pun intended, but I guess there it is, which is you have an amazing story to tell, but you don't have the funding yet to shoot the spec footage for somebody to see whether you actually are qualified to tell a story, and that still is a big challenge. So I think there are a lot of folks just starting out who end up just shooting their spec footage and having to work on it. But you should look at some of those opportunities because I think it's better than it used to be for brand new filmmakers in docs. It's not super great though. But it's such a great art form.
You know, it's going to constantly be a challenge. I mean, there's always, fledgling documentary filmmakers who are trying to figure out how to raise the funds. And you struggle to, one of my suggestions is you try to find someone or find an organization like Firelight Media who can mentor you and help you and maybe give you some seed money to start doing some shooting, and when you get organizations like that attached to you, then when you go out to to an IDA or you go to the Ford Foundation's Just Films, people will say, oh, she's involved with Firelight Media, because it opens up an avenue for you. That's a way to try to do it, You really have to sometimes attach yourself to an organization like that or to someone who's more experienced to become your executive producer, believes in your project, who can sort of, they can say, oh, as any age people always say, Sam Pollard's name's on everything, it can help you get into the door, it's always a struggle. I mean, even for those of us who are seasoned filmmakers, you're right, the pot is so finite. We all fight. We're all fighting for those dollars in the documentary field.
Thank you for that question. Over here.
Hi. I just want to say thank you so much for coming out and giving this talk. My question is also sort of about documentaries. I feel like sometimes when a story is told and awareness about a subject is raised, the subjects of the film don't, their quality of life or whatever issue or whatever oppression they're fighting doesn't go away. There is awareness, but the problem still persists. And so my question is, are there examples of documentaries that have been produced that you've seen that not only raise awareness, but directly fight an issue so that the issue doesn't, the stories don't become sort of exploitative? Because I feel like I've seen documentaries that tell incredible stories, but I haven't seen sort of action that's directly come out of it. Sorry, heavy question.
That's a very crucial question. And at times I have watched films and wondered what is going on after this film ends for the people who are the subject of this film. I think that is a really important question that brings up activism in a different way than you've been talking about it. But I can't give you great examples. Some of the examples that I'm thinking of are long ago, so.
I'll give you an example. A film that won the Academy Award, and someone who can remember the title, about the young kids in India.
Born into Brothels,
directed by Ross Kaufman. They went into this community in India and they helped these 9 young kids learn how to be photographers and stuff. But what those filmmakers did, because these kids their mothers were prostitutes, or sex workers, I'll use that term. They were sex workers. And most of those young ladies and men, their lives didn't get any better. But what these filmmakers did after that film was made, they raised funds to build a school for those kids. And one of those young men from that film ended up going to NYU and studying film. He was one of the students I would see in the halls, and some of the others have gone on to do other things, you know, so they got out of that lifestyle. So there are some documentaries where the filmmakers have a responsibility to help the people that's in the film. Listen, there are some films, documentaries, where they're in a community and they go and they shoot, you know, and they come out and they don't do anything. But, you know, that's always a complicated thing when you're making documentary films. You know, the responsibility you feel other than being just a filmmaker, you know.
Another documentary that's relatively recent, except for I can't think of the name of it. It's about the student orchestras that were made in, is it Brazil? It's Brazil? I didn't think it was Brazil, but I don't know how many of you have seen this. It's a documentary about a rural community and a person who had become a teacher, was from that community, become a teacher, and then went back to the community and decided to have a school orchestra. But they didn't have any money to buy any instruments. So he worked with local people with their crafts. There was like a cabinet maker and someone who knew how to weld, and they got together and made all of these instruments that were homemade kinds of instruments. And then they started playing and recording around the country. And then people in the musical world began to hear of it. So famous musicians from around the world came to work with these students, get them real musicians, get them real instruments, mm-hmm. and get them to play. So they were able to raise money to tour around the world to play. Did anyone else see this but me? I can't remember the name of it now, but it's incredibly compelling. Do you remember the name of it?
Claim for Change.
Yes, found materials.
Is it Garbage Dreams?
Some of them were like metal cans. It's an incredible story.
Garbage Dreams, you
said? Garbage. You saw it too. Okay, five people here saw it. If you get a chance to see this, it's very interesting because it's a really good example of how getting a documentary made, which allowed people to see it, then brought aid to this community. And they interviewed the parents who said things like, this is great for my child. This is going to give my child the opportunity to live in a way that I never had a chance. But that's really an interesting example of something like that.
Just really quick, just in case you're actually really curious about digging deeper in this question, there's an organization called BritDoc that comes from the UK, and they also have offices here. They actually curate a lot of really great case studies about what happens around activism around documentaries. And I think your question is exactly right, because there are the ethical considerations about what happens to the actual characters that are on screen with you. And then there is the advocacy and the activism that happens around the issue that includes those people but may not necessarily be the same thing. Mm-hmm. And I think those of us who are in that space need to be constantly paying attention to that. But there are many examples. I'm glad you talked about Born into Brothels. There's a movie called Playground, which was instrumental in passing safe harbor laws for young children who are being trafficked in this country for sex trafficking. Right. That film was instrumental in passing state laws around the country. Mm-hmm. There's the movie Bully, which actually completely changed the conversation around bullying, particularly about lesbian, gay, young people. So there are so many examples, and there are many case studies on that site, BritDoc. So.
Thank you.
Thank you for that question. You guys are going to hate me. I'm so sorry, but we have to wrap up this panel. This was phenomenal. Thank you all so much for being a part of this.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Coming.
Do you want me to ask one more question, or are you looking at me to like, am I getting the Harlem Apollo broom
that's
sweep?
It.
Or is that what's happening?
No, we're not going to force you off, but that's it. Yeah.
I got to go home, but you guys know how that goes. Thank you guys so much for joining us. Appreciate
yes.
it.
Thank you.
Thank you so much to the panel. Thank all of you. Now, by the way, this is not the last thing. We do have a few clips from the Jazz Ambassadors movie that is not done yet that's coming out, and also a performance by the Smithsonian Jazz Masterworks Orchestra, which I'm really excited about. So those of you who are signed up to see that, you can find information about that as you exit. Other than that, we're going to go ahead and clear this theater. Thank you so much, everyone, all right?
Thanks, Faith. I keep asking, do you want